Hello, my name is Sabina O'Hara, and I am the Dean of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. We are not in the studio today, but we are on location at a facility called Eden. Everyone deserves to eat naturally, which is affiliated with Regeneration House of Praise, right on Martin Luther King Avenue in Southeast Washington, D.C. And we are here for a special edition of Causes. The University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences has partnered with Regeneration House of Praise, also called the Church in the Fields, to embark on the next chapter of their Garden of Eden, Everyone Deserves to Eat Naturally. By blending advanced urban agricultural technology and a passion for growing food as a means of improving the health of the community and creating jobs, we have expanded Project Eden from a traditional garden to a system of growing fish and fresh produce together through a recirculating system known as aquaponics. This project follows the successful installation of a small portable greenhouse, or hoop house, earlier this year. To date, the church has already grown 600 pounds of food, thanks to the addition of the small greenhouse. I talked with Regeneration House of Praise Pastor Cheryl Mitchell Gaines about economically empowering the community through the church's ability to grow food, host hands-on education and training events, and to Che Axum, director of the Causes Center for Urban Agriculture, and to Professor Thomas Kukovic, inventor of a unique water aeration system that is the heart of the aquaponics facility here at Regeneration House of Praise. Pastor Gaines, it's great to be back out here at Eden. Everyone deserves to eat naturally. And since the last time we spoke about the status of the project, a lot of things have happened. We've been very, very busy out here. So what's happened?
Great things have happened, Dr. O'Hara. We have the completion of the hoop house, greenhouse. We have the installation of the aquaponics system, and we have the addition of the fish. And I find that to be so exciting.
So you actually have fish tanks in the greenhouse now, not only the vegetable beds, because last time we spoke the vegetable beds were going in.
Yes.
And we had some gardens in there and you were growing vegetables.
Yes.
But now you have fish.
Now we have fish. I like to say that this is fishes and loaves. God has made me a fisher of men, and now when the men and the women come, we're able to teach them how to fish. Instead of just giving a fish sandwich, we're able to teach people how to fish, good nutrition, the economic development that this is going to be providing and has provided even already for Southeast Washington, D.C., and just being able to offer healthy, nutritious food and fish.
And fish. And you're going to be raising, what, tilapia here?
We're raising tilapia. We're excited about that. It's a good fish, as you know. I was actually introduced to tilapia in this area, and I am really happy about it because I was able to myself introduce the fish to this environment, and I found that to be very exciting as well. And they're very, very feisty.
They are feisty.
They're very feisty.
They are more tolerant than some others.
More tolerant than some of the fish that we as a community-based church might not be able to support as well. Uh-huh. So we're grateful for the ability to start with the tilapia and look forward to the harvest as well as the nutrients that will be provided to increase our yield of vegetables and fruit.
So what has the reception been like? I mean, this is the first time, to my knowledge, that anything like this has happened. in this neighborhood, or maybe even all the way across Ward 8. So have people been
You're going to steal
receptive?
My thunder. I'm going to tell you about the Light of Eden. You're going to steal my thunder. I wanted to talk about it in our presentation, but I'm going to have to tell you what happened on last night. I came back. It was late, and so we were doing some final touches on Eden, and the lights were on in the hoop house, and we put a security light in, and that security light was on as well. And as I got out of my car, I could notice that there was a lot of activity taking place. And when I walked up, one of our neighbors, Miss Helen, was there, and she was saying, I saw this man, I heard him jiggling the fence, and I came out here to make sure no one was breaking in. And she told me the whole story of how not only her, but I mean, there was a young man out, there was the resident manager over here had come. Everybody had come to make sure that nobody was tampering with Eden. It has been very well received. Yesterday we had a little boy in, Jaja they called him, and he wanted to touch the fish or play with the fish, but he was able to touch a watermelon instead. And his grandmother has come to see when she could come and get some of the produce. So
wonderful.
It's been a wonderful, wonderful reception.
Wonderful. So the neighborhood seems to be very excited.
Yes, excited and beginning to own it.
Yeah.
Every time I see people, I said, this is for the community.
Yeah.
You know, it's a community garden, and so it's going to empower the community. So it's been exciting to see people catch on and enjoy it and be the neighbors that we know we can be to one another.
Yeah. And you know, I have to tell you, our staff at Causes is equally as excited.
Thank you.
Because some of our extension agents who've been in this business for a long time, they come back to the office and say, this is their favorite project. This
wow.
is a gratifying project because there's so much close collaboration between people in your congregation, people in the neighborhood, and
yes.
and our staff, and there's so much mutual learning going on.
Yes.
You know, because what we're learning too, as we've been working through the implementation of this project with you, is we're learning a lot about where we use way too much lingo, right? Extension agent, land grant lingo, and academic lingo. And we thought, wait a minute, there's got to be a better way of teaching these things and getting the point across. So I want you to know that we're learning at least as much as you're learning.
I was talking
with
Dr. Che. He was talking about the learning curve for those out at your farm.
Yeah.
I said, well, if you all have a learning curve, you can imagine what we have.
Yeah.
And he said, yeah, you know, and so we've all been learning. It's been a wonderful process, though, and I believe that what we have here is replicable.
Yeah.
And so what you all have been able to do with us here at the community level in the church, you know, we're able to take this to other communities and other churches and other community-based groups to empower the community around the idea of not only good nutrition and healthy food, but economic empowerment and development.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really important. And as you know, the last time I was here, we talked about how we had been broken into and someone had stolen our computers and cut a hole in the ceiling. Well, I can tell you this time, look at the contrast.
Yeah.
Last night, people were telling Dr. Amen, who built the hoop house, what are you doing at the gate? What are you doing at that fence? And so that's a big difference. It took a lot for whoever stole our computers to get them out the window.
Yeah.
It was about 7 of them that they took.
Yeah.
And they cut a hole in the ceiling. That's a lot of noise. And so it was probably a sense of see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. But last night, the community was mobilized to say, not over here,
mm-hmm.
not over here. And that's what we need. We need more community engagement. We need to bring people together as a neighborhood. And I believe Eden does just that.
That's a beautiful story, actually. And the evolution is really beautiful. So you've now designated people in your congregation to be able to continue to work with us.
Yes.
Yes. To sustain the project.
Yes.
So when's the first vegetables, fish sales planned? I know the fish is going to take some time, right? They
yeah,
have to grow
the
first.
Fish, I understand, takes, and remember, I'm not a gardener, nor am I a fish farmer, but I'm learning.
Yeah.
And so I've been told that the fish are going to be fully matured at about 6 weeks, 6 months rather,
mm-hmm.
6 to 9 months. And 6 months, if we can get them out, we can get the new ones in sooner and increase our yield. And so I would think that we probably will have a sufficient yield to be able to market and give away by in about 30 days or so.
Wonderful.
And so what I also want to tell you is God has given me a formula for this. And it's found in the Bible with Joseph in Genesis. And it's 10% tithe, as always,
mm-hmm.
20% preservation, and 70% is going to be the economic engine that keeps this going and employs people and continue to help us to move forward in our vision, as you know, which includes a food truck. And so putting it out to market, you know, using that truck and also putting out prepared foods in that way.
Well, Pastor Gaines, it sounds to me like there will be lots more follow-up stories for us to talk about.
But I certainly
thank
hope
you
so,
for
Dr.
this morning's conversation and congratulations
thank
on
you.
The official launch of the aquaponics system in Eden.
Thank you. We couldn't do it without you, and we love you dearly.
Thank you. Ward 8, located in Southeast DC, is known as a food desert. That means it's an area that lacks access to fresh food. Projects like Eden help to promote food security or the dependable, steady supply of healthy food. People living in food deserts are often supplied by inexpensive fast food, leading to such health issues like obesity, diabetes, and hypertension. According to the Washington Post, 37.4% of the district's households with children are unable to afford food. That is a rate that is among the highest in the country. These households are food insecure, which means that they're cutting back on meals or don't have enough to eat on a daily basis. Wards 7 and 8 have the district's highest obesity rates. And ironically, they're also the largest food deserts. Of the 43 grocery stores in DC, only 3 are located in Ward 8, a stark contrast to the 11 stores that are located in Ward 3, DC's wealthiest ward, with the highest median income. I talked to Jay Axum, director of the Center for Urban Agriculture in Causes, about what it takes to grow nutritious food in Ward 8. And I know you have been a big, big proponent of sustainable agriculture. And it seems to me that aquaponics is one example of how that works, right? How one works with a system, not sort of as a throughput, but in a circular fashion.
Yeah, it's very important because as urban areas become more intensely populated and wherever they are in the world, you're going to need to feed people and feed people in small places and use small plots of land and small areas and small containers to feed as many people as you can. So it's extremely important. It's extremely important. And recycling those nutrients in a way that can be used over and over again is the future.
So tell us, what's the connection? You know, people may not necessarily make that connection between what you call sustainable agriculture, growing food in small places, even in urban neighborhoods like these, between that and people's own nutrition, people's own health. Well, I think a lot of people may not necessarily make that connection.
Well, if I can give you an example here, one of the things we're doing here, we'll be growing fish.
Yeah.
One of the critical elements that is kind of missing in most of our diets is omega-3 fatty acids. We get enough omega-6 from different things, from soy milk and nuts and beans. We get enough omega-6, but the omega-3s are what is critically missing mm-hmm. in the diet. Mm-hmm. So the more of those omega-3s that we can bring into the diet, the better it will be for all of us and for cardiac health and everything of that nature is critical. And recent research has shown us that, you know, sometimes just taking that pill of fish oil might not be as good for us as eating the whole fish.
Uh-huh.
And so growing the fish in areas like this, and density, growing quite a bit of fish, and preparing the fish correctly,
mm-hmm.
not really deep frying it too much, broiling that fish, baking that fish, and eating the fish is going to really increase everybody's heart health.
Uh-huh.
And that's very critical because that's one of the things that's really missing in everybody's diet is the omega-3 fatty acids.
So it's what you eat, but also how it's prepared.
Exactly.
And also how it's grown.
We're
growing vegetables here too, and I know you are a big proponent of what you call growing foods that are high in nutrient density.
Yeah. Well, in this greenhouse today, I mean, when we take a look, I mean, we have some of the super vegetables. Kale. Kale is a super vegetable. Very
super
high.
Super vegetable.
Super vegetable.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, along with some other vegetables. Kale is on the top of that list as far as nutrient density. So we'll grow kale and collards and other dark leafy green vegetables, which are super nutritious and pretty much you can grow many of these year-round. Mm. That's the thing about it. You can grow many of these vegetables year-round.
In a greenhouse?
In a greenhouse, yeah, year-round. So that's critical. And, you know, since we all really, really don't get enough vegetables in our system, this is the excellent way to do it. And growing the correct ones with the highest nutrient density is extremely important.
So what others are there? I mean, people know about collards and kale.
Well, all the plants in that family, all the plants in the brassica plant family, the collards, the kale, the broccoli, the cabbage, the cauliflower, the Brussels sprouts, all those important, super nutritious crops are essential to health.
Uh-huh. What about some of the others? You know, I'm a big tomato and pepper fan.
Well, tomatoes, peppers, certain types of tomatoes have higher vitamin C than other tomatoes, so we would grow those certain high vitamin C tomatoes here. Certain types of peppers have higher vitamin C contents than other peppers, so we really look for those particular crops which have the highest nutrient density and which have really been bred to have the highest amounts of those important phytonutrients and vitamins.
And when you describe these crops and how much food you can grow on a small space, it seems to me you're doing it somewhat differently than what I might do in my backyard, right? Because I put my tomato plant in somewhere in late May, and I have to tell you, it's still in there right now. But our tomatoes here are all gone.
Well, that's just the varietal selection, because when we start growing different types of tomatoes, they are indeterminate tomatoes, and they are determinate tomatoes. Determinate tomatoes grow to a certain height, and then they just stop producing. Indeterminate tomatoes grow continuously on and on and on throughout the season. So the varietal selection of what we pick to put in here is extremely important in these small spaces. We can't just throw any kind of crop in there or any type of vegetable. The varietal selection and genetic selection is extremely important.
So what you're actually then doing is you're rotating crops in the same space, and you're planting more than one over the course of a growing season.
Exactly, and those rotations will be different because each particular crop takes up its very specific nutrient. Like some crops take up more phosphorus, some crops take up more potassium. So that's the rotation that we really will work on. So we'll put one crop in a bed, and if that crop takes up more potassium, we don't want to put another crop in that bed that needs potassium. We want to put a crop that's in that bed that maybe needs more phosphorus. And then we'll rotate those beds, and then we will check the soils to test them to see which nutrients we need to add to those particular beds. And root crops require certain nutrients, so we'll look at those rotations, and we will plant in order of the nutrients being taken up by the previous crop. That type of crop selection.
So there is a lot to learn urban agriculture and working with the nutrient cycle.
Yeah, and it's different too, because I mean, if you have a large space, it's different, but these intensely small spaces where you have to really deal with mixed cropping systems and things like that, you have to really be up on your soil science and your soil pH and all these things. It's very important to get the productivity that you need.
The Regeneration House of Praise's aquaponics project will have larger implications as well. Traditional farming requires the use of large amount of water, fertilizer, and as a result, it also creates a considerable amount of waste, contributing to environmental problems. But because of the efficiency of the closed-loop aquaponics system that recirculates water and uses fish excrement as a fertilizer, the system has a very small footprint and very limited environmental impacts. With me to talk about this particular aquaponics facility, which is even more amazing because it miniaturizes fish production, is Professor Kakovic, environmental science professor at UDC. So explain to us, what's behind this innovative technology that makes it possible to have fish tanks right off of Martin Luther King Avenue?
Actually, it is the smallest, it is the first of its kind around the world. It's the miniaturized fish farming. And the device that you're required to have, it is an aerator, because without compression, without any mechanical move, it's molecular suction. And it's the size of a cup. And it will take about 80 to 90 gallons per minute through the smallest section, and you could hear it probably back there. The sound is like the jet plane flying because it is sucking air in. And then it is emulsifying air with water. And that is the key. And it has to go through the tank, and then we have to remove the air because you do not need bubbles. If you have bubbles, it becomes a problem.
So it's a very small device. You said the size of a cup,
the
roughly?
The size of a coffee cup.
Wow, the size of a coffee cup. And it sucks air in from the
atmosphere.
And it mixes it with the water.
It emulsifies it, actually.
It emulsifies
molecule
it.
To molecule, surface tension of air to water. It will molecule, it will actually blend it.
Like, so mixing up. Like in a blender.
Like a blender.
High speed, so that it's not just sort of sticking together, but it's really sticking together.
That is correct. It is 30,000
RPM. 30,000 RPM. That's pretty fast.
That is very fast. And of course, basically mixing the air molecules and water molecules, what we call emulsification, and then putting it right into the water.
But how do you get that speed without having, you know, some big spinner or something, which is what you normally would use?
Right. That is basically mechanical, mathematically designed. It has no moving part. The water molecule will do it. And as they do it, they will suck the air right into it and mix it. So the blender part is actually the water molecule. We do not use anything but molecules, molecule to molecule.
So you're using the speed, which with the molecule itself spins, to bring the oxygen from the air and insert it into the water molecule.
That is correct. Water molecules are like marbles.
Yeah.
And you got billions of marbles going around.
Yeah.
You don't need any moving part. They're the best moving part, and water is incompressible. Once it takes air in, it will compress it. You don't need multi-stages, you don't need any equipment. You just need to understand the mathematics and mechanical design of it.
So you already have all the moving parts you need.
Yeah, which is water.
In,
which
in
is
the size
of an opening, which is that big.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay. That's how the oxygen gets in. And of course, the genius is that normally, when you say fish farming, right, people who are in that field and who are familiar with fish farming, they think multiple huge swimming pools somewhere out in the country, because it takes that much water and it takes a pump in those swimming pools for the fish to get enough oxygen in the water to stay alive, because they need the oxygen to breathe, of course. And so that's been sort of the limitation to putting it in a facility like this. So with the device, you can shrink the whole operation,
yes,
right?
Because the fish farming that used to be done would require 400 gallons per a pound of fish. Of course, the more water you have, the more aeration you need. It's obvious.
Sure.
So what you have to do is, to maximize the efficiency, what you have to do is minimize the amount of water, but maximize the amount of oxygen in it. You must have about 10 parts per million of oxygen in that water. Now we are down to 2 gallons per pound of fish.
Wow.
From 300, 400, all the way. The most efficient is 22 gallons. Mm-hmm. We are 2 gallons.
Wow.
So you could put this in any urban area, anywhere around planet Earth. You see, this is a parking lot.
Yeah,
this
right.
This is between this car A and car B.
Right, and the whole hoop house is only about 20 by 35 feet or so, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So you got all the fish tanks in there.
That is correct.
So, and then when the fish do their thing, right? They eat.
Right.
And they excrete.
That is correct.
And then what happens?
Well, we have to use the full cycle. It's a living body. Actually, what this is a living system. The whole thing is recycled. The excrement is used, goes to anaerobic and then to aerobic. And then is used, nitrate are removed, change into nitrogen, because plants do not need nitrate. And then you use that as fertilizer.
Mm-hmm.
That's the part. So the whole system is recycled back and forth. We have aquaponic and aquaculture simultaneously within a small section within a van size place. And we could produce about 500 pounds of fish and 5,000 pounds of vegetables.
Wow. So it's not only a highly efficient system where you get 2 gallons of water per pound of fish. It's
That's
an
correct.
Incredible efficiency. But you then also close the loop, so there is no waste from that system.
Yes.
Which again makes it very usable in an urban neighborhood like this, because when you close the loop and there's no waste, then you don't have that problem of taking the waste away or having, you know, fish excrement and stuff in a in an urban setting like this. So that's really pretty genius.
Environmentally solid and also economically very feasible.
Mm-hmm. What you've been able to do with this kind of system is really to use the way nature works and to work with nature to make that whole cyclical process of fish production and efficient plant production work.
The technology is related, it's sophisticated technology, but using absolutely natural events. Let the molecules of water, which are incompressible, to do their job to compress the air and emulsify and dissolve oxygen in water. Mm-hmm. You put it in a fish tank. You minimize the amount of water. And then what you do, you have 2 gallons per pound of fish, and then you cycle, you recycle the excrement of the fish, turn it into fertilizer. That is really a nutshell, which makes it economically feasible to have it anywhere on any urban areas, anywhere on planet Earth.
The launch of this cutting-edge small-scale aquaponics facility will take urban agriculture to a new level. The project is also well aligned with the Sustainable DC initiative, a vision of Mayor Vincent Gray for DC to become the greenest, healthiest, and most livable city in the country. According to Mayor Gray, this vision creates a better tomorrow by focusing on social equity, economic competitiveness, and environmental quality, all at the same time. I would like to thank my guests for being here today for this special edition of Causes. If you would like more information about our topic or about the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia, please visit our website at www.udc.edu/causes. Thank you for watching. I'm Sabina O'Hara, Dean of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences. See you next time on Causes.